senator here, so we gotta.
I like that.
We're just, we're little house members.
Yeah, we're gonna sit down, or we're gonna sit?
I'll just start by saying hi. My name is Susan Kent, and I'm the senator from District 53, which includes this part of Maplewood, Oakdale, south of 10th Street, Lamphall, and Woodbury. And I want to thank everybody for coming out. I got a little chilly again on us this morning, so thank you for being here, and we're all looking forward to a really great discussion. Very quickly, I'm just gonna do a quick little, let's sort of map this out, so, because what we really want to do is make sure everybody has a chance to participate, that if there, that issues all get to be addressed, and so we want to just sort of lay out some ways to work this so that it's sort of fair for everybody. So to make sure that everybody who has a chance to speak is able to, we're gonna start by giving everybody a turn with one question, and then if everybody's had a chance to have a question asked, then we'll go back around and people can start having second chances. We're asking that, because there are so many of us here, that questions be submitted on note cards, and I know there's some there, and Joann just stepped out, she's in a striped shirt, but there she was waving. Joann is my legislative assistant, in case anybody ever is trying to set an appointment, that's who you're speaking with. And so she's gonna collect those, and we're not doing this to edit them, I want to be really clear, but it's just saying that if five people are basically asking the same question, we'll kind of deal with them at once, and then we can come back and dip dive a little deeper later if we've gotten through all the basic topics that everybody wants to cover. And we do ask that everybody keep their question pretty brief, you know, keep it to focusing on what the question is, 30 to 60 seconds, hopefully. Sometimes people get frustrated if someone uses the opportunity to make a sort of a 10-minute speech, so in the name of fairness. So we're gonna start with a brief introduction with our speakers. Like I said, I introduced my district really quickly. I'll tell you that my committee assignments are all the education committees in the Senate, that's E12 Finance, Education Policy, and then Higher Ed and Workforce Development, which I really enjoy because this gives me a chance to look at the issue of education from early childhood all the way through lifelong learning. And we're doing some really exciting things there. I'm leading a working group in the Ed Policy Committee that's focusing on making sure that our kids are graduating from college, up from high school, ready to go into post-secondary, whether it's four-year college or two-year or other sort of post-secondary certification programs. It's all about really being very strategic on what our future workforce needs are gonna be, that we're preparing our workforce and our kids to have the best lives that they can have. So it's some really pretty exciting stuff, and I look forward to sharing more details about that as they develop. And then my other committee is I'm vice chair of transportation and public safety, and there's a lot of exciting stuff going on there as well. And so with that, I'm gonna be quiet and sit down, and okay, and then Joann Ward, my 53A counterpart.
Yes. Good morning, I'm Joann Ward. I represent District 53A, which is the northwestern part of Woodbury, the older part of Woodbury, South Maplewood, South Oakdale, and all of Lamphall. And then Susan's, the other half of Susan's district is all the rest of Woodbury. So if that helps you kind of get the map in your mind, where she is. I'm on four committees now. I was on GovOps until very recently when we had a special election and there was some shifting around of committees. And I was able to drop one because four is a lot better to manage than five. It's not normal for people to carry five committees unless they've been there forever. Anyway, so I have both environmental committees. It's environment, natural resources, and ag policy, or sorry, finance, and then the environment, natural resources, policy committee. And some of you may have been reading recently, there have been some stories in the papers about the living wage job committee. It's a select committee, which means that it comes from the speaker rather than being a standing committee. And that's distinct from the minimum wage jobs that we've entered up. They're two very different things. So I am very glad to be here. I'm glad you're here. I see lots of friendly faces, and I'm looking forward to hearing what your issues are and how we can help.
Good morning, my name is Peter Fischer. I represent 43A. That's the northern part of Maplewood, parts of White Bear Lake, Montevideo, Birchwood, and Willerney. I appreciate you all coming here. Very quickly, the committees I am on. I serve as vice chair of the Environmental Natural Resource Policy Committee. I am also on the committee for Health and Human Services Finance. housing finance and policy, and labor and regulated industry. I appreciate y'all coming here. I'll wrap up at this point because I really look forward to hearing what you folks have to say. Thank you.
Good morning, I'm Leon Lillie. I represent 43B. We have new numbers, so it's always kind of, I want to say 55A, but now it's 43B. I have the middle part of Maplewood and most of Oakdale and North St. Paul. So I'm in my fifth term in the Minnesota House, which is kind of neat. It's fun. I have a bunch of committees I'm on. I'm on capital investment. I'm vice chair of Legacy, which is the, so they look around at these parks and trails and stuff. So that's kind of, I'm really into that sort of thing. And then I'm on commerce and rules, which is an interesting committee if you ever want to talk about something kind of fun. I always like rules. It's whoever's in the majority, which we happen to be at the time, you make up the rules. So it's an interesting committee. Anyways, it's an interesting session. I'm sure you're watching the news, what's going on. There's all sorts of fun issues and some not so fun issues. So Representative Fischer said, just looking forward to hearing what you folks have to say. So I don't know if the center has a big plan. I was thinking we could just kind of start at one end and just work from the other. Just briefly introduce yourself before we get to the questions.
Okay, and real quick, I did want to say just one more thing that I forgot to mention. Senator Wieger really wishes he could be here today, and he sends his regards and his regrets. He had a previously planned engagement and tried to reschedule it so he could be here, but he wasn't able to. But we felt it was important, especially for Representative Ward and Peter Fischer and myself, that since it's our first time, we wanted to get out and visit the folks in Maplewood. So, but you know, Senator Wieger always has you guys in his heart and is only one in 60.
What district is he?
He is the senator for 43. So those, the Senate district is the two House districts. So, okay, all right. Winnie, do you have questions on the cards that we want to start with?
Or? Yeah.
Can we just go real quick, like start over here, just kind of see where's home, and you know, some of the folks might not actually have questions, so you just want to say what's important to you, and then we'll actually get to the probably more in-depth questions.
Well, we're Jim and Andrea Fischer, and we're probably your constituents because we live over in Cardinal Point on Hadley, and we're here just to get to know you all, and because we appreciate that. There's some people who are representing us, so we'll talk to you afterwards. We don't, a little fiscally conservative, but you know.
I'm Oakley Bezant. I'm the staff here at the Maplewood Nature Center. I welcome you all. You're welcome to come back and see us more for our excellent program, and our nature trails are wonderful too.
Thank you for hosting us. Oh, this is a great place to
have. Let me know if you have any questions. I'll be at the desk.
And I'm Bob Schmitz. I live at the south end of Oakdale. I'm in Leon's district. I was in Nora's and lost her, but I'm so glad to see you made it, Joann.
My name is Mike Bullerman. I live over in Woodbury. I consider myself an animal welfare advocate, and I'm here to talk about the wolf hunt.
My name is Steve Hunt. I live in North St. Paul, and I'm also member of the District 62 School Board.
I'm Paul Hyland, and I'm in Representative Ward's district, and obviously Senator Kent.
I'm Joe Ward. Joann is my spouse, so I'm a supporter.
How's she doing?
Good.
He's not sure he never sees her anymore.
Well, she's been hard at work, you know. It's pretty impressive, our new, I'm just speaking for, I'm an assistant leader in the House, and I can't tell you, our new team is just, I'm really impressed, you know. And to be honest, in fairness, a lot of the new Republican members too, I mean, I'm a Democrat, but a lot of the new, I mean, it's really a good slate of candidates, and these two in particular. Well, I don't know if Susan as well, but I know she's doing great, and she beat a great, she beat my brother, so I know she's, you know, they're really doing a nice job. I'm sorry to throw that in. I'm pretty proud of Minnesota, the candidates, and the quality, the caliber of people they've sent. So.
I'm Candy Marcus, I live in 43A, which is Peter's district.
My name is Christopher Bay. I just moved into Joann's district.
I'm Jan Yeomans. I'm a neighbor of Representative Ward, and I'm here just to learn what's going on.
I'm Dave Hutchison from North St. Paul. I spend my life trying to decide between the DFL and the Independence Party. I'm just gathering more information.
I'm Kelly Bryan. I'm in Joann Ward's district, and I'm here in support of some bills that are in the House and Senate that are being stalled. So I'm just interested in then getting a hearing.
I'm Bruce Greasy. I live in Peter's district. I've been a delegate on occasion. For your interest, up there, I actually work for the Department of Transportation of the City, see a lot better than at those communities. I'm just here for general information as well. So.
Can we get you guys in the back? And we're going to get you camera people too, by the way, just a warning.
Rory Sanders. I live in Oakdale, and I'm the president of the Teachers Union.
Nate Zenker from 53A.
I'm Cher Franey from 53A, Joann's, and Susan's there.
Fred Hess from 53A. Marriage equity is a big issue for me, and I just wanted to hear what everyone had to say about that. Also, I know there's some legislation pending on bullying, and I'm very concerned about that because I think our schools need to be safe places for children.
I'm Janie Makepeace. I work for the House DFL Caucus.
I'm Dallas Pearson. I'm in Leon's district.
I'm Elizabeth Skelnick. I'm in Susan Kent and Joann Ward's district, and I met Susan's, as Joann's husband. He came to our home. My wife is on her way here. She just dropped her son off at symphony practice and is trying to make it. And we're here in support of the marriage amendment, and we're hoping to get your support on House File 1054 and Senate File 925.
I'm Richard Newmark from Joann Ward's district, and I'm an advocate of alternative energy, especially solar energy, wind energy, and transit issues like bicycling and busing.
Greg Larson from 53A. I've had the pleasure of being in Senator Kent and Representative Ward's offices personally, and I'd just like to say they're super professional and approachable. And in the environment we're in right now, I really appreciate that we have that kind of representation in the House and the Senate. And I know your brother.
Me too.
He's a good man.
I'm Rich Benner. I live in Peter's district, and I wish Peter would give us more like advance notice on stuff going on the White Bear Lake level issues. I know you've gone to the meeting, but if you could put it on your website or in your stuff so we can see it in advance when these are, so we could go.
Sure.
That'd be just great.
Dave Hughes, we live in Peter's district, just kind of here to get to know a little bit.
And I'm Cece Hughes. I was in Peter's district as well. And I'm actually very interested in homeless youth and children's mental health and education. But I used to live in White Bear, so White Bear Lake is very important to me too.
Hi, I'm Deborah Kelly, and I'm actually not in any of your districts, but your actions are affecting kids in my district of Stillwater and kids throughout the state. And I'm very interested in education. I work in education. I do research in education. And so I'm very happy to see what you're working on. And I would offer myself and others as a resource to you. I specifically, though, want to ask you to move along the bills for Purbridge and Crosswinds and get those heard. I know they're being stalled, and I really appreciate your support on that.
I'm Carrie Dixon. I live in Maplewood. I'm in Representative Fischer's district as well as Senator Weegar's. I'm here to speak to you all in support of the Crosswinds Purbridge bill. I'm also thrilled to have seen the historic legislation that was entered this week in support of marriage equality.
Good morning. I'm Len Frese. I live in Woodbury, and I'm here to support my friends who got elected to the legislature. Thank you for your service. It takes a lot to be a public official. And thank you for having this town meeting. It gives us a chance to hear what's happening, but also to give you input. I'm the executive director of Conservation Corps in Southern Iowa. We put young people to work outdoors, and so I'm obviously interested in getting support for any funding that can help us do that.
Fred Fox, I used to be in Nora's district. Now I'm in Leon's district. I actually met Leon about 7 or 8 years ago at a block party. He probably doesn't remember me. But anyway, I find I learn more by listening than I do by talking, so that's what I'm here to do. Although I do have a suggestion for the representatives to consider after the meeting.
I am Ron Cockrell. I live in Maplewood, about 200 yards from here. I'm the current chair of the Maplewood Parks and Recs Commission. I'm here to say thank you for supporting and sponsoring a bill for the Fish Creek Preserve. In fact, I want to give you each a jar of Fish Creek Preserves. I think it's really a good idea, and I appreciate all that you do for this. Thank you.
You know, these people have been bugging me. I'm on the LCCMR. I didn't mention it, so it's one of the committees that I'm on top of some of the legislative, it's an extra committee, and these people have been bugging me nonstop about it. And there's another almost $200,000 in there for Fish Creek. So in the bill that's going to go through the legislature, it just went through the committee. Now it's the bills have been turned in, so and another $200,000 for Fish Creek. If you get a chance, get out there and see it if you haven't been in there. And
he's I added extra champion. Sugar, so it'll take care of any bitterness down there.
I'm Jason Raster. I live in Oakdale, and I'm not sure how I got on the newsletter, but I'm receiving emails from you, which I think is great, you know, seeing what you are dealing with in the legislature, so it's nice to get on that list. But I lean heavily to the right side, so nothing against that. But I'm here to, this is my first time doing one of these, and thanks for your email on here, and I'd like to hear what you guys have to say about what you're doing to preserve our Second Amendment rights, and also what we're doing to limit the need to continually raise taxes instead of living within our means, just like all the families have to do.
If I can just interrupt real quick and address that. I thank you for being here, because we want to be clear that we recognize that we represent everybody in this district, and we do want to hear all sides. Thank you for being here. Sorry, go ahead.
I'm Tom Raster, the dad, and when my son called me this morning and said this is an opportunity to meet with Minnesota legislators, I hurried down from Hugo, which is up by Forest Lake, so although I'm not in any of the districts, Lynn Runbeck and Roger Chamberlain or Mike representatives. Nonetheless, you know, what you guys decide certainly affects everybody regardless of where you live. So I wanted to come down here and also give my two cents for you, particularly on the Second Amendment.
Hi, my name is Raymond Oscus. I'm on the south side right here. Mr. Fisher is my representative. I'm here because I've got a lot of concerns about my tax dollar. I'm not here asking for money. I'm asking you to protect the taxpayer dollar.
John Stackpole, Pete's area, Gladstone, a little Gladstone area. I'm just here to, listen and contribute. I'm more concerned with where our money gets spent. I think more money should go. Air quality in the state is right up there, fifth worst in the nation, I believe. And it's all coming from vehicles. Why we're not spending more money on the highways, because we're so far behind. Why we're funding billionaire stadiums and stuff like that. So I'm sure you've gotten a few messages.
Did we get everybody? Have we had anybody arrive since we started? And do a couple of anybody else?
Okay. Great.
All right. Thank you, everybody. Yeah. If Michael, you want to start?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I just brought a couple of quick fact sheets for my two legislatures, Joann and Susan. I guess my question was just where y'all stand on it's been proposed to bring back the moratorium, or the 5-year moratorium on the wolf hunt. And we got off to a great start. It was a bipartisan agreement to begin with until Senator Hahn and Senator Senjum pulled their support back. So I just want to know, I know the odds are against us and the situation's grim, but what are you guys' position on that? Thank you.
I will say that given my focus on education and transportation, that is not, and being here in the metro, that is not an area that I've studied in great detail, but it is something that I have paid attention to, and I do have some questions about it. I want to study it. I'm sorry we didn't get to meet, and look forward to meeting you next week and talking about it further, because I do have serious questions about some of the issues surrounding the way this is being handled, and make sure we're doing it right.
And I could say the same thing. It's huge. People are very concerned on both sides about this. So we're still listening.
Okay, thank you.
Anybody else want to? I'll just, because I'm on one of the same committees that Joann is at, would deal with this as it comes through. And I've got concerns on the wolf hunting. The other thing I'm also concerned about is with the crash and moose population. They don't know how much of us are factoring into that. And so I've kind of, and that's why I'm a little hesitant to say where I'm going to fall on that, to see what their impact is here, because if the moose population continues to plummet the way it is, we'll lose the moose population. And so I want to make sure that we're doing what we can to protect that. So I just want to put that out into the mix also.
I've been tracking it pretty closely. It's on LCCMR, so for the last couple of years. And
tell people
that. I said LCCMR, I meant Lassard Sams. It was. So I actually said it wrong, but so we've been talking about it in quite detail, although my position is probably not exactly like theirs. I think the DNR decided on their own to do the wolf hunt, and I'm not sure it would have passed the legislative body even last term, and I'm not sure it would this time. I would probably vote against it. I think for my personal, representing my district, I think the hunters or the folks that have farms, there's also the problem of, probably the other factor is if they're attacking your cattle or if they're attacking things on your farm, you can shoot them and you're getting reimbursed by the state and those sort of things. And I would continue to support that, but just a regular hunting season. But I don't really fully blame the DNR. The animals are there. They can manage it as a... like any other hunt that they might have. So, I mean, it's a trickier animal. I don't know where people are, but, for our Indian neighbors in the state, for them, it's a brother, it has a different, than a rabbit or some other sort of animal. It has a different relationship with them. So that gets a little tricky, but I think even most Minnesotans would kind of go, well, do you really need to hunt a wolf? You don't eat it. You don't, it's nice, beautiful pelt, but that's about it. Anyways, it's a tough vote, but I would vote probably to stop it.
Nate?
Hi. I'm from 53A, by Representative Ward and Senator Kent's district, and thanks again for having this opportunity for us to come up and talk to you. Although, just for the record, it would be nice to get a little bit more than less than 24 hours notice in the future. I had to move some things around so I could be here, but I do appreciate the opportunity. My main concern, I think, going forward this session probably stems from probably more on the economic side of things with some of the governor's proposals. Especially changes to the sales tax in the state. And I've got a couple specific concerns about it, but while I understand the concept of lowering the overall rate and broadening the base, I think it also has to be recognized that based on his plan for an increase in spending, saying it's going to bring in more revenue, obviously it is going to be a net tax increase. And for people in the average to middle income range, adding that tax on to things like food, clothing, labor, things like that, that is going to affect your lower and middle class citizens, because we're now going to have to spend money on sales tax on those things we didn't have to before. So now when I go to the grocery store or we'll go to JCPenney's or Target or wherever, it's going to cost me more money to buy those things that I wouldn't have had to spend otherwise. And my second concern on that is adding the taxation on labor specifically, that number one, I think that's something that's probably going to be very difficult to regulate. And number two, you're going to be putting an awful lot of burden on people who otherwise wouldn't have had to file those forms. And it's also a second bite at the apple, because all those labor rates are already taxed either through the income tax or through the corporate tax. So now we're actually going to be double taxing people's labor. And I have some real concerns about, you know, what that might do to, you know, especially small business people who are maybe working part-time repairing vehicles out of their garage at home, or, you know, things like that. That it's now it's going to add more burden for them, more paperwork they have to file with the state. And I'm curious to hear where you stand on that, and, you know, what effects you think that might have.
Thank you. You raise a lot of really great points and great questions. To sort of step back a little bit from the big picture, the concern is that we continually have deficits in our budget right now. You know, we're the revenue we're bringing in do not meet the expenses that we have. And I know there are concerns about living within our means, and I definitely hear that and understand it, and I am all for finding all the waste we can find and getting rid of it. But at the same time, we are losing ground in education and transportation and some other critical areas. You know, when you hear engineers from around the state talking about the state of bridges and roads, it is a serious problem, and we've got to figure out how to address this. I have some concerns and questions, some of which you've definitely brought up with regard to the governor's budget proposal, but I want to say I really congratulate him for his approach, because I think it is fiscally sound in the sense that it puts us back in a structural situation that we can pay our bills, okay? But within that, I do have some questions. Going back to his priorities in terms of getting fiscally sound and putting our investments in our future, education and transportation, that's where I think he's got a good approach. But he himself has said this is the first word and not the last word. We just got the February forecast on Thursday, which changes things a little bit.
And it's up, correct?
Yeah. And so it's going to take a couple weeks for them to sort of take his proposal and reprice it basically in the context of the new numbers, and so we'll see in a couple weeks where that stands. The both houses are going to be getting their targets together, and we're going to sort of go from there. On some of the specifics you mentioned, one thing I would say about, and this goes back to the structural way we finance our government, our sales tax as we have it right now, first of all, it's relatively high, and secondly, it reflects the way the world used to work. In the old, back in the 50s, and just, sorry, getting ahead of myself. Right now, about two-thirds of our economy is service and one-third is product. That has flipped. It used to be two-thirds product, one-third service. So we've got to figure out how to do that, because what that means is we're losing some revenue there. So I think the approach that you're referring to in terms of broadening the base and the lowering the rate is deliberately set up so that a middle-class family will not pay more after, you know, they'll pay less on their shampoo and their toothpaste and their school supplies, but they will pay a little more on some other services, so that at the end of the year, the amount of sales tax they're paying should be about the same. And that was deliberate on the governor's part. So I think it's interesting. And part of my perspective on this comes from economic development. We need to keep our state competitive so that we can bring businesses in here, not chase businesses out. And by bringing that state tax rate down, it helps us stay competitive. So, but I also share your concerns about the business-to-business taxes. I think that makes us less competitive. And so I know there's a lot of discussion about that, and I support that discussion. I used to own a small business. My background is marketing. I've worked with a wide range of companies, and I know firsthand exactly what you're referring to, and I think we need to be very cautious on issues like that. Do you guys want to address anything?
I would just emphasize a little bit more the importance of the investment in education and infrastructure, because that does impact the economy in terms of business development, recruiting new businesses, keeping businesses in place and growing strong. Transportation is huge. People don't come here unless they can get their products to market and they can get their raw materials in. Their workers need to be able to get to work in a reasonable way. So there's a huge part of the economic development that is related to transportation. The other part is, of course, education, because we are known for to be an educated state, and that's one of our triggers. We can only grow if we continue to have people ready to move into the workforce. As Susan said, it's a first draft. His budget was a first draft. We've all been talking about it in various committees, how the impact is going to fall on different situations, different people in different ways. We're not, any of us, interested in taxing people more. We're trying to redistribute we hear a lot of getting local government tax back to the local government, mm-hmm. letting and taking the state's responsibilities back as a whole. So the cities and counties, communities have been struggling mightily. The bottom line is, though, that we're still trying to do a lot with less. Every business has been doing that for many years. We have to find some other ways of doing things.
I guess if I can ask you to do one thing for me with regard to that, it's please look at the math on the governor's proposals, because based on the numbers you just told me, it doesn't work. Because if in fact two-thirds of what we spend our money on is service, labor, and one-third is goods, if we're going to reduce the rate on that to what I would call this 5% or 5.5%, something along those lines, but then we're going to also add on a 5 or 5.5% tax on the two-thirds that we weren't paying it on, that math doesn't work out that it's the same for everyone as what it was before.
We recognize that it's challenging.
And I understand that it's not finalized, but I'm asking you to please keep a close eye on that so that, like I said, I understand the concept of trying to broaden the base and lower the rate to try to bring in more revenue and whatnot, but we need to make sure that the math works on that for everyone in the state and that we're not punishing people who are bringing jobs here.
Absolutely, that's the bottom line. You know, the best way that we can grow revenue in our state is to have more jobs and have more people working at good wages, and then that way, we spread it across more people. We individually each get to pay less.
And our tax situation in the state has driven business out. There's a reason why Sioux Falls has grown at the rate and clip that it has across the border in South Dakota, because they don't tax businesses the way that we do. They don't tax income the way that we do, and it has given them more opportunity to steal business from our state. The industry I work in, which is the fire service industry, I used to be a firefighter, and now I work training fire departments and helping to build equipment for fire trucks. We lost a pretty good company out of our state, Laverne Fire Apparatus, down in southwestern Minnesota, which is now over in the Sioux Falls area for those very reasons.
I appreciate hearing the input that you're providing here, because the governor's budget is a starting point, and by the input that we're receiving from you folks today, this is what we'll take back and toss into considerations. I like what you're saying is, particularly when we're talking about the food, and clothing concerns into there. That's a common concern that we're hearing across the board. And what you're seeing, in discussions, we're all discussing the governor's budget and the input we're receiving, we will bring back. But some things that we want to keep in mind a little bit as we're doing this is that, that's one part of the equation. The other part that we are also looking at is trying to find efficiencies in government going forward, and that's an important part. And some of the things that are driving it is that we wanted to have something that is helping prevent the wild swings that we have going on with our current tax situation. And also in the current sales tax situation, we have some unfairness in there. An example is in the private sector, when businesses make capital investments, they have to pay the sales tax up right away and then go through a complicated process to file forms to get that sales tax rebate. I'm in the nonprofit world, we're able to get our sales tax discount right at the point of purchase. I've got a bill that was introduced and heard in committee. That's one of the things that we've got in to try to address it. That becomes part of it, and that's why I'm tossing out, because it's all part of this overall balance. What we're going to do is the sales tax will I think may look different than it does today to help address this concern. Another part, and this affects everybody in the room, is all of our local governments pay sales tax. Up until 1991, they did. So the cities, the counties, and your school districts. And when you start adding that in,
the cities and counties and townships are coming from it.
So you've got kind of a hodgepodge, and on the cities and counties, that's about another 1 to 2% that they pay each year. So in some ways, when you're trying to support things, if you solve the problem by taking it away from them, we have to look at the overall way to keep it consistent. But when we correct it at the government level, that helps take the pressure off some of our local government agencies and gives them a little bit more room to work with things.
I think it's also important to make sure we don't have unintended consequences too, like turning my neighbor's kid into a criminal if he's not paying sales tax when I'm flipping him 20 bucks a week to mow my lawn.
When following on, I think, a little bit of the conversation, it was mentioned earlier, the world has changed. So I think when you're looking at a budget proposal, I hope that you'll also look very carefully at programs that maybe are outdated in the world as it is today. And maybe there are entire programs that can be discontinued to free up money to invest in some of the future priorities that I think you've correctly identified.
Hang on, I've seen your hand. Okay. I just want to make sure that everybody has a chance to answer his question. Leon, did you want to add anything here?
No, I just want to say I appreciate the way you're, you know, you're asking it. You're asking respectfully. So thank you for that. I'm on taxes, so we've been talking about it. Tax committee in the Minnesota House, we've been talking about it, and we've had meetings of members behind the scenes. And but I really respect the governor for bringing forward a proposal. I just think he's having an honest discussion. When I first started, I said in my introduction, I said I've been in my fifth term, and honestly, it's been crazy. So I really value personally that just having an honest discussion. I think at the end of the day, I think it's going to be very different than it just started. And Senator Kent mentioned that in her kind of comments. It was kind of the first deal, and he's made it clear that was plan A. He realizes there might be a plan B, C, D, or whatever. But I think at the end of the day, what we see is going to be very different. So thank you, and thanks for asking it, nicely. It's a real question. What do we value as Minnesotans? What do we want Minnesota to look like? These values. I don't know how we want to do it.
I just want to get some information out.
Yep.
When you talk about the transportation, and you say we're underfunded, 25% of that funding does not go for roads and bridges. It goes for bike paths, snowmobiles, and things like that. We might want to stay on course with the funding and keep it where it belongs. Number two, you talk about education. Last year, the legislature gave out an extra $50 to $100 more for people. Okay, we are spending more on education than we ever have. But we are not doing evaluations on schools or teachers or anything. I'm not willing to give my tax dollar out for more education until I see some results from the schools. Our school system is still not precious as it was. It is down by, I think it's down right down to 30 or 35. So it is not the top anymore. So we need to consider that. And those are the things, and as far as your ranking as your capital, your income tax and your sales tax, we are ranked number 6 for sales tax in the country. And if you think we're gonna, they don't have the money. And when he says it's a wash, if it's a wash, why are we doing it?
Well, that's no, because he would bring the rate down, so we're not number 6. That's the point.
But if it's a wash to the taxpayers here, why would we do it?
We'd go from 5th to 27th, the rate.
But we're on more stuff.
But that's the way it is in most other states.
And those other states don't have an income tax.
Let's say this, too, that we can't fix it all in 1 year, and we are all seeing what's happening worldwide with austerity measures. So, cut programs, you're hearing with the sequester now, military and all of the other segments of society are looking at layoffs. Where are these people going to go?
We're cutting less than 1% on a budget. I'm sorry, but don't give me the fear factor. I don't believe it. And as far as paying out $44 billion over 7 months, and the last is over 9 years. It is less than 1%. And how much are you cutting from your budgets, everybody, right now? And our taxes are going up, our Xcel energy bill's going up, and you're telling me that we can't cut anything in the state of Minnesota?
I didn't say anything.
Well,
yeah.
Said that we need to find ways to cut.
You
where
should
we
look
can.
At the human services. We've got 46% of our budget goes directly there. 46%.
We're going to need to move on to the next question. There's a lot of other people who have questions as well.
You asked a question.
Let's move on to that.
I spent a lot of time on this topic, and I know there are a number of other topics. Carrie, you have one?
Yes.
And I know it was you and Deborah as well.
Carrie Dixon, I'm a Maplewood resident, Representative Fischer. I am in School District 622. I'm not here about my kids. I'm here about all the kids of the East Metro. I'm concerned that a fantastic school, Crosswinds Arts and Sciences School, is risking closure so that a single school district can get a state-funded school building free and clear. I want to thank Representative Fischer for supporting the bill on this, supporting Perpich's ability to take over Crosswinds and therefore continue the program for everybody's kids to be able to attend. I'd like to know from the others that are here, if you support the ability from students, for students from many districts to attend Crosswinds School in the state-funded school building. Thank you.
Education master.
Thank you for asking that question, and it is a question that I have spent a lot of time listening to people. I called Kelly back after I got an email from her, and there are a lot of serious discussions going on about this. There is a lot of, I think, misinformation going on about what is happening and what will likely happen. Just to be clear, I don't necessarily support this notion that the buildings would go to anybody free and clear. I think that is not necessarily the best use of state dollars, even though I live in the district that would be getting it to. I'm here to say I don't see this as a big pork barrel project for my district. But the problem with this is, and I live very close to Crosswinds, I value Crosswinds, I know it means so much to its families and its students, and I understand that. But these issues have been going on for a couple of years, and this plan came up with a very brief deadline, and it brings up a lot of complex issues, as you say, from a statewide basis. As somebody who sits on all these education committees, I have to think about what this does on a number of issues that set precedent, that cost money, that kind of thing. It's being proposed as an integration project, but right now our integration plan and funding is set to sunset. It'd be great to be able to factor this into the bigger discussion of integration, but that's going to play out over months, mm-hmm. not 2 weeks. Mm-hmm. You know, and then you know, we still haven't seen the numbers on this. I have a lot of concerns about the cost of this, and we still haven't seen any of the numbers. It is said that it's going to be revenue neutral, but it's not going to be. If it's set up the way that I've read the bill, it's not going to be revenue neutral to South Washington County Schools or St. Paul Schools or the other schools from which they'll be building that enrollment. So, because that money will come from those districts to
following their own students.
Right. Yeah. Right. But it affects the school. It affects the districts around them. You know. And so, my point is, because Perpich, and I love Perpich, I admire Perpich, I support Perpich, and I actually have questions about what this means for Perpich. It's complex. And Perpich is, I think, very excited about this and has mapped out a really potentially great scenario, but is missing a lot of the complexities of this that are very serious conversations that affect everybody. And so I'm just trying to get everybody to stop and listen to it and think about all the ripples that this little pebble might have.
But you're delaying.
Hang on a second. We can't get into a big debate. It's not about delaying. I want to be clear. It's not about delaying. It's about stopping to make sure we have the information that we need to evaluate these questions.
And what that does is it makes another.
We are trying.
Is the problem.
We are trying.
Your concern about time is our same concern mm-hmm. about time. That is something that was imposed upon us by our own school district, and you know, some that had conflicts of interest.
And I hear you. And that is my question. I mean, there's an article that I read from the Star Tribune from the fall of 2011 where parent groups from Crosswinds were saying Perpich should come in and take this over. Mm-hmm. Well, on the E12 Finance Committee just a couple weeks ago, Senator Westrom brought in a bill from the western part of Minnesota, and it's a consolidation of a very small district named Cyrus, about just over 30 students now, in Morris, And everybody agrees. It's, you know, everybody agrees they need to consolidate. There's no controversy. There, you know, the only issue is there's an old elementary school building that has asbestos, and Morris doesn't want to get stuck with a big bill on that one. So they're looking for a little state support to potentially resolve that. They've been working on that plan for a year and a half before they brought it to the legislature. And so that is the challenge. Even in something as simple as that, you know, you got to have the time to look at it. And this EMID proposal has been brought to this issue, and in a way that sets up a lot of questionable precedents with really challenging timing to try to evaluate it all. So it's not necessarily about delaying it, because I understand the deadline. I'm concerned that the deadline that was set is still too late, because everybody's got staffing challenges, and we all know the calendar of staffing in the school districts. So anyway, because of the way you have to, you know, hire and do contracts and everything.
Teachers are there. They're there for purpose anyway.
But it affects everybody. All of these decisions. It is late in the year to be making decisions. So anyway, I just want to say it's not about delaying. It's about making sure that all the questions can be addressed properly.
I appreciate your comments and concerns about.
We really need to make sure that people get their questions heard. Wayne.
Yes. Thank you. Sorry, I was late.
Glad you're here.
Representative Ward, Senator Kent, I live in your district in Woodbury, and I wanted to talk a little bit about the autism issue. We've been moving legislation through the House successfully, now we're about ready to start up in the Senate, and what we're talking about is one, insurance coverage, because currently right now we're seeing a major migration towards DHS. And services, taxpayer-funded services. And what we really like to do is move that off the burden of taxpayers and into the private insurance world. So Senator Kent, you're gonna get a pretty good dose of this over on the Senate side now. I think we're parked in the HHS omnibus for a while. Just to let you know that. The other issue is that.
Tell them why, because the insurance doesn't cover, right?
Some of the 2001 Attorney General Mike Hatch sued Blue Cross Blue Shield for discrimination. We got the coverage, but only in Blue Cross Blue Shield plans. That settlement and that agreement expired in 2008, but we've been asking Blue Cross Blue Shield to stay on till we can get an insurance mandate. Now, a lot of people have problems with mandate. Reality is, without coverage, we migrate to taxpayer-funded services, and it's costing the state a ton of money. We want to stop that. We want to move it back into the private sector. The impact is not significant, as we've seen in other states, yet the plans say this is going to blow premiums out of the sky. It actually doesn't. So, one, we're coming forward in the Senate, so we're going to see that. Yesterday, a lot of people, if they watched the news last night on WCCO, they had an issue down in Olmsted County, which is what, Rochester, where a nonverbal child, kind of like my son, who's nonverbal, who was, I think, 12 or 13, and he was basically pushed around by a teacher or administrator, and thus he couldn't tell his parents what was going on. The school district kind of hid this for a while, and it finally came out several days later. So it's kind of like a bullying issue where you don't, you know, the victim can't tell anybody because he doesn't know any different. The attorney general yesterday, the district attorney, announced he's not going to seek charges. We knew that. So we've already got a federal suit ready to go next week for civil rights infractions and a few other things. But we knew that. Senator Senjum is going to add some language to an existing germane bill, because I guess it's too late to really introduce new bills, to allow or to require within 24 hours parent notification. These parents did not know what was happening to their child for several days. So we need to look at that. So you know, I'm just letting you know this is coming down the pipe. But the insurance coverage is very critical. And our battles with that have to be, you know, the opposition saying, no, it's going to cost a lot of money. Actually, it doesn't. But if we don't do anything, it's going to cost all of us, the taxpayers, and continue to cost the taxpayers a tremendous amount of money. So, thank you.
I would like to just add too that a huge percentage, roughly 25% of the school education budget is really in social services, mm-hmm. and we're having a discussion about how that can be addressed differently, because the perception is that, you know, we're pouring all of this into the classroom, and we are, if you take that into consideration, but the perception is that if the teachers are getting wealthy and, you know, the schools are wasting the money, but we are continuing to add social services to the schools. I'm seeing some heads nodding, yes, you know that. It's a huge challenge. And do we pull social service funding out, or the social services out of the funding stream for schools, so that that can be better understood and maybe addressed in a different way? That's just part of the conversation.
Good.
All right, in order to respect, you know, everybody's time, we can have a kind of a wrap up, and if you have any questions, you can ask them, you know, after we are finished wrapping up, and for people who don't get their questions answered, your representative will follow up with you on note cards that we have your information on.
I'd be happy to stay a little longer.
I just want to thank everyone for coming today. I appreciate it. I'll stay around afterwards if you have questions. Thank you for taking time out of your morning to be here. And I appreciate hearing the views from across the spectrum, because it's real important as we're going forward trying to form our opinions, and particularly in budget areas. We're dealing with the budget coming up. So thank you for being here today.
Good. Likewise, I just want to thank you. And, you know, many of you can be very easily involved, you know, whether it's by email, you can follow what we're doing, you know, you can send us messages, or you can watch what we're doing, how we're voting on different things, and you know, it's pretty easy nowadays to see how we vote for or against things. You can figure it out, and you can respond pretty quickly. So when we're on the House floor, we can. So when I was co-authoring the Viking Stadium, right? Sorry about that. But you know, it's really an honor to serve in the Minnesota House, and these people are doing a good job as well and taking it serious. And hats off to you, Steve, for what you do for our kids. And, you know, a lot of discussion this morning is about our kids and the, you know, be careful what you wish for. I have a daughter that's an artist, and she's out at Berkeley in Boston, and a music school, and it's pretty expensive. So when you get all these kids going to Purpose, you might go to expensive music school. I'm just warning you.
Actually, they go all over.
You know, it's just funny that I love the arts, so it's a great discussion. I didn't really mean to throw the mom up again.
Sorry. I also want to say, if you want to be on our newsletters, you need to sign up for them. You can go to our website. You can go to the House or Senate website. But if you're not hearing from one of us that you want to hear from, it would be helpful if you would sign up for our newsletter, because we can't put you on the list. That's not legal. So thank you all for coming. I really appreciate it, and I will stay.
Three trees next time.